What if the world around you isn't real? The chair you're sitting on, the air you're breathing, even your most cherished memories. What if it's all just lines of impossibly sophisticated code? What if the laws of physics aren't laws at all, but programmable rules? It sounds like science fiction, but some of the sharpest minds on the planet are starting to believe it's not only possible, but probable. The idea that we're living inside a giant computer has officially escaped late-night dorm room chats and sci-fi blockbusters. It's now a topic of serious debate among physicists, cosmologists, and tech visionaries. This is the simulation hypothesis, the theory that our entire reality, from the smallest atom to the largest galaxy, is a completely artificial construct, a massively detailed program running on some colossal computer in a higher, base reality. For a long time, this was just a mind-bending thought experiment. But as our own technology becomes scarily advanced and our understanding of the universe deepens, we've started to notice some glitches, peculiarities in the fabric of reality that just don't seem to add up. The evidence, some argue, is hiding in plain sight. So today, we're going down the rabbit hole. We'll explore the philosophical arguments and the scientific clues that suggest our world might be the ultimate illusion. Be warned. After this, you might start to see the coincidences in your own life a little differently. Before we dive into the wild science, you should know that questioning reality is one of humanity's oldest pastimes. Thousands of years ago, the Greek philosopher Plato gave us his allegory of the cave. He imagined prisoners chained in place, forced to watch shadows flicker on a wall. To them, these shadows weren't just representations of reality, they were reality. They had no concept of a world outside, with real objects and a real sun. Their entire existence was a world of projections, a low-res version of the truth. Centuries later, the Chinese philosopher Zhuangzi wrote of a dream where he was a butterfly, fluttering about, perfectly happy. When he awoke, he was struck with a powerful question. Was he Zhuangzi who had just dreamt of being a butterfly? Or was he a butterfly now dreaming he was Zhuangzi? It perfectly captures the dilemma. The line between our perception and reality can be impossibly blurry. This line of thinking was pushed to its limit in the 17th century by René Descartes. He sought one thing he could be absolutely certain of, leading to his famous conclusion, cogito, ergo sum, I think, therefore I am. Yet, while he knew his own mind existed, he couldn't be sure about anything else. He posed a chilling scenario. What if an all-powerful, evil demon was deceiving him, feeding him every sight, sound, and feeling, and none of it was real? These thinkers laid the groundwork. They showed us that our senses, the very tools we use to navigate the world, can't always be trusted. Plato, Zhuangzi, and Descartes were all asking the same fundamental question we are today, just with different metaphors. They had shadows and demons. We have computers and code. But the core question remains, how can we be sure that this reality is the real reality? For centuries, the simulation question was purely philosophical. You couldn't run an experiment on it. But then came the 20th century and the discovery of quantum mechanics. Suddenly, reality started to look a lot stranger and a whole lot more like a computer program. At the quantum level, the building blocks of our universe don't follow the rules of common sense. They seem to obey a different, almost digital logic. The most famous example is the double-slit experiment. You fire tiny particles like electrons at a barrier with two slits. You'd expect to see two corresponding lines on the detector screen behind it, but that's not what happens. The electrons act like waves, appearing to pass through both slits at once and creating a complex interference pattern of many lines. Here's where it gets truly bizarre. If you place a detector by the slits to observe which one the electron goes through, the very act of looking forces the electron to pick a side. It stops behaving like a spread out wave and acts like a simple particle, and the interference pattern vanishes. It's as if the universe doesn't bother rendering a definite outcome until something is there to observe it. This has led some physicists to a startling comparison: video games. A game engine doesn't render every detail in the entire world at once. That would take too much processing power. It only renders what the player is currently looking at. The idea that reality might also operate on this need-to-know basis is a huge part of the argument for a simulated universe. And the weirdness doesn't stop. Take quantum entanglement, what Einstein called spooky action at a distance. Two particles can be linked so that even if separated by billions of light years, they remain connected. If you measure a property of one, you instantly know the corresponding property of the other, faster than any signal could travel between them. It's as if their states are bound by hidden information, like two variables in a line of code programmed to always mirror each other. It feels less like nature and more like programming. Every computer simulation, no matter how powerful, has limitations. A maximum speed, a finite memory, a specific resolution, you can't have infinite detail. So if our universe is a simulation, we should expect to find similar limits, a kind of cosmic resolution or frame rate. And it appears we have. One of the most fundamental rules of our reality is the speed of light. Nothing can go faster. It's an absolute hard-coded speed limit. But why should there be a limit at all? In a simulation, a speed limit is a perfect way to cap the processing load and prevent the system from crashing. But the clues get even more specific. Physicists have discovered the Planck length and Planck time. The Planck length is the smallest possible unit of distance. Below that scale, our understanding of physics breaks down. Likewise, Planck time is the shortest possible unit of time. It's the time it takes light to travel one Planck length. The existence of these indivisible units has led some scientists to a wild conclusion. Our universe might be pixelated. Just as an image on your screen is made of millions of tiny pixels, our reality could be built from discrete blocks of space and time. If you could zoom in far enough, you wouldn't see a smooth, continuous reality. You'd see the universe's source code. This idea is supported by a new field called information physics. Physicist Melvin Vopson has even proposed a second law of infodynamics. We all know the second law of thermodynamics states that entropy or disorder tends to increase over time. But Vopson suggests that in many systems, the information does the opposite. It becomes more ordered and compressed. He argues this is the universe constantly optimizing itself to run more efficiently, just as a computer deletes junk files to save space. This drive towards simplicity, he claims, is a massive clue that we're inside a giant, self-optimizing computation. While the clues from physics are fascinating, the most powerful argument for the simulation hypothesis comes from pure logic. In 2003, Oxford philosopher Nick Bostrom published his simulation argument. It doesn't prove we're in a simulation, but it argues that one of three very strange possibilities must be true. This is his trilemma. First, imagine a civilization like ours continues to advance. We went from Pong to photorealistic VR in just a few decades. Now imagine that progress continuing for thousands or even millions of years. A post-human civilization would almost certainly have enough computing power to run ancestor simulations, incredibly detailed simulations of their past, inhabited by people like us. Given that, Bostrom says one of these three things is almost certainly true. Option one, civilizations are doomed. This is the extinction proposition. It states that civilizations at our stage of development almost always destroy themselves before they can run ancestor simulations. Nuclear war, climate change, an asteroid, take your pick. Basically, no one ever builds the simulations because no one sticks around long enough. Option two, civilizations aren't interested. This is the disinterest proposition. It says that advanced civilizations could run these simulations, but they simply choose not to. Perhaps they deem it unethical, or maybe it's just boring to them. For whatever reason, the simulations are never switched on. Option three, we are almost certainly in a simulation. This is the logical conclusion if the first two options are false. If civilizations do survive and are interested in running ancestor simulations, they would likely run billions of them. In that scenario, the number of simulated people, beings with thoughts and feelings just like ours, would be astronomically larger than the number of real people in the one base reality. Think about the sheer numbers. For every one real organic universe, there could be billions of simulated ones. If that's the case, probability alone suggests it is overwhelmingly more likely that you are one of the billions of simulated minds, not one of the original biological few. According to Bostrom, you have to pick one. And if you think humanity has a decent shot at survival and will remain curious, you are logically forced toward the incredible conclusion that you are probably living in a simulation. Big theories about physics and probability are one thing. For many, the real evidence lies in the strange, unexplainable moments of everyday life. Have you ever been hit by a powerful feeling of deja vu? That bizarre certainty you've lived a specific moment before, down to the last detail? What about the Mandela effect, where large groups of people clearly remember something that history says never happened? Proponents of the simulation hypothesis suggest these aren't just quirks of our brains. They could be literal glitches in the matrix. Deja vu might be a moment where the simulation's code stutters and a previous event gets reloaded by mistake. The Mandela effect could be evidence of a software patch, an update to the simulation's history, where some of us retain fragmented memories of the older version. And what about those strange coincidences that feel too perfect to be random? You think of a friend you haven't spoken to in 10 years, and your phone rings a minute later. It's them. Is that just chaos, or could it be a deliberate plot point written into your story by the programmers? Of course, science offers other explanations. Neurologists theorize that deja vu is a tiny misfire in the brain. The Mandela effect is often explained by our brains filling memory gaps with plausible information. These are rational explanations. But for those leaning toward the simulation idea, these personal glitches feel like powerful anecdotal evidence, quick peeks behind the curtain of reality. Of course, not everyone is sold on this. The simulation hypothesis faces a lot of pushback from the scientific community, and it has some major problems. The biggest hurdle is that the entire idea might be unfalsifiable. A core principle of science is that a theory must be testable. There has to be an experiment that could prove it false. But how do you prove you're not in a simulation? Any evidence you find could just be another part of the program designed to keep you convinced. Another huge problem is the sheer computing power required. Critics argue that simulating an entire universe down to every single particle would require an amount of energy so vast it's physically impossible, even for a hyper-advanced civilization. Simulating our universe might be impossible for a computer that exists within a universe like our own. Then there's the consciousness problem. The simulation argument assumes that consciousness, your inner world, your thoughts, your feelings, can be coded and run on a computer. We have no idea if that's true. Consciousness might require a biological brain, meaning it can't be replicated in silicon. If so, then we can't be simulations. Though we could still be real brains jacked into a simulated world, like a brain in a vat. Finally, there's the who simulated the simulators problem. If we're in a simulation, what about the beings who created it? Are they in a simulation too? This leads to an endless tower of simulations that doesn't answer the ultimate question of existence. It just kicks the can up another level. For these reasons, many thinkers believe that while it's a fun thought experiment, the simulation hypothesis is a dead end. We're at a fascinating crossroads. We've traveled from Plato's cave in the bizarre world of quantum physics, from Nick Bostrom's logic to the frontiers of information theory. We've seen how our universe, with its built-in speed limits, its pixelated nature, and its strange habit of only rendering things when they're watched, seems to have all the hallmarks of a design system. And we've wrestled with the unnerving probability that if anyone, anywhere can create simulated worlds, we are almost certainly in one. At the same time, we have to respect the counterarguments, the mind-boggling computational challenges, and the deep philosophical knots that make the hypothesis so tricky. So where does that leave us? Are we biological beings in the one real reality? Or are we bits of data in a simulated world? The honest answer is, we don't know. But perhaps asking the question is what's most important, as it forces us to confront the biggest questions of all. What is reality? What is consciousness? And what does it mean to be human? If this is all a simulation, it doesn't have to make our lives meaningless. Our joy, our pain, our love, it's all still real to us. This simulation would be our universe, and its rules would be our physics. Whether it started with a big bang or a big boot up, this existence is ours. So what do you think? We've looked at ancient philosophy, quantum weirdness, and statistical arguments. Which piece of evidence hits you the hardest? Let us know your theory in the comments below. And if you enjoyed this trip down the rabbit hole, Make sure to subscribe and hit that notification bell so you don't miss our next journey into the universe's biggest mysteries. You're watching Deep Synapse, where science meets the soul.